I've been interested in the Maya culture for over 25 years, and basically I fell in love with Maya culture on my first trip to Central America back in 1986. I was just a young guy who had saved up some money, and I wanted to get south of the border and visit some of those Maya temples. And I'd read about that there were Maya people still down there in the villages, and I wanted to learn about the calendar, you know, from the source. And that began the whole journey. Can everybody hear me okay back there? Is this a good volume? Is it good? So I'm going to dive right into this because the slides really sort of drive this along. And there's a lot of different sections that I'm going to be getting into. And I hope that it's not bewildering or anything like that. I tend to ramble too much in my prelude, and then I sort of start covering some stuff that's really, you know, a part of the presentation. So we'll sort of launch into it. My whole work has really been dedicated to reconstructing what 2012 meant to the ancient Maya. This seems self-evident, you know, but as 2012 has evolved in the popular marketplace, we see a whole spectrum of things out there. From the doomsday illusion to, you know, all systems and models and all kinds of different things. And I know that it's very hard to separate the signal from the noise if you go out onto the Google sphere and try to figure out what this 2012 thing's about, or what the Galactic Alignment is about, or what the Maya calendar's about. You know, there seems to be a lot of conflicting ideas and information out there. My approach has been to honor and respect the authentic Maya tradition. There are indeed basic core facts of the tradition that we should all agree on before we start doing our own philosophizing. And that's all I've really been advocating over the years, is that let's get straight, you know, on the basic information and go from there. My work is really as an independent researcher, which basically means that I can say progressive things without the fear of getting fired. I don't know, this has been my passion, my life work, and I started writing articles in the late 80s. Basically, when I first went to Guatemala, it was like 1986, and so there was a lot of political stuff going on. There was the death squad activity, and I really awoke to that whole situation there. So a lot of my early work was kind of more politically oriented. And I went back as often as I could, usually every winter, if I could squirrel away enough money to do it. And I delivered relief supplies, and I helped rebuild a school in San Pedro. Into the early 90s, I started getting more interested in the Maya calendar and the astronomy, and was devouring all the academic research and information on the Maya. And I realized that there was this enigma with 2012, you know, according to the correlation of the Maya calendar with our own calendar, this big cycle, this 13 Bakhtun cycle, which is a period of about 5,125 years, falls on the December solstice of 2012. Now, that was pretty interesting, you know, that seemed to suggest that there was some kind of intentionality built into the calendar, that it fell on an exact solstice. And nobody in the academic literature was really saying much about that. And so I started to investigate this 2012 mystery. Now, to understand the Maya calendar, it's more than just some kind of mathematical, calendrical thing. The Maya calendar incorporates elements of astronomy, mythology, spiritual teachings, and the creation myth. And there's really two aspects of the Maya calendar research. One is the 260-day sacred calendar, which is kind of the core building block of the whole Maya calendar systems. That system still survives in the highlands of Guatemala. There are many different Maya groups speaking different dialects of the Maya language, the Quechí, the Quiché, the Zutuhil Maya. And they're all still following this 260-day calendar that's sometimes called the Dzolk'in, a count of days. And it's quite clear that this is an unbroken calendar that's been followed. You know, the sequence of days has been followed. Going back to the classic period Maya, 1,000 years ago, before that, you know, for as long as the 260-day calendar has been being followed, this same sequence of days has been tracked. So that's pretty amazing. There's been this continuity of calendar tradition going back some 2,500 years, unbroken. But the long count calendar that gives us the 2012 cycle ending date, that fell into disuse 1,000 years ago. The last date carved in stone in the long count calendar is from the early 10th century. And, you know, there was kind of a short count that got continued in the Yucatan. And we see this in some of the books of the prophecy books of the Chilambalam priests. But the short count, you know, started to do it in a different way. And so, you know, by the time of the conquest, it was totally distorted. And then it was completely demolished by the late 1700s. So the whole effort to reconstruct what the long count calendar meant to the ancient Maya has been a process of research and drawing together the data and the evidence and looking at the different sites and the different, you know, parts of the tradition that could shed light on what this calendar was about. And that's really what I've been engaged in, is a reconstruction of a lost aspect of the ancient tradition. Going along with the sort of nuts and bolts reconstruction challenge, I've always been sensitive to the spiritual teachings that seem to go hand in hand with the astronomy. That's one thing I realized, is that, you know, the scientific astronomy and the spiritual teachings and the creation myth, well, certainly these have to be two totally separate things, right? No, that's an assumption of our own tradition. You know, we, in our own scientific tradition, we tend to compartmentalize these two different things. And even a lot of professional Maya scholars, they seem completely unable to talk about the spiritual teachings and the astronomy in the same sentence, because in their own minds they compartmentalize these two areas as being completely mutually exclusive and separate. But the Maya themselves, they had an integrated worldview. These things went together. So my challenge and my you know, being sensitive to the interrelationships between these two domains, I've always wanted to talk about the spiritual teachings and the creation myth and how they go hand in hand with the astronomical alignments that you find in Maya cosmology and in the calendar. So the 2012 story is my most recent book. It's kind of one-stop shopping on all things 2012. It's came out 2 years ago. Here's the paperback. So it's out in paperback now too. And maybe I could just read an excerpt from the introduction just to give you a sense of where I'm coming from with this. Kind of puts things into perspective a little bit. It's called 2012, An Unstoppable Idea. Writing this book was an immense undertaking that had to accommodate new developments and the ever-shifting features of a quickly evolving field. Because of the curious crescendo in our immediate future, and therefore unlike any other topic, 2012-ology has been growing exponentially with a unique set of issues and attractions. This accelerating growth of interest in the public arena is driven primarily by urgent doomsday scenarios spun out by the mainstream media and opportunistic writers. And yet the date is not simply some newfangled gadget invented by the marketplace. It is, in fact, a true artifact of the authentic Maya calendar, which has suffered the cut and paste cosmologizing of wannabe wizards, pocket protector prophets, and celebrity showmen. This heady stew is all stirred up in the Google cauldron, making a dangerous potion for the unsuspecting newcomer. Yeah, that's kind of what I've observed happen in the 2012 discussion over the last 20 years. It's almost as if you can't, it's, you know, the real information starts to get buried by the noise in the marketplace. And believe me, I've been there. I know I've interviewed with the History Channel, Discovery Channel, all those places. And they seem dead set on presenting the exact opposite false information about what 2012 meant to the ancient Maya. To be honest with you, I mean, in a nutshell, it's like there's no evidence at all that the Maya predicted the end of the world in 2012 or had any kind of cataclysmic, apocalyptic idea about it. You don't get that in a cyclic time philosophy. Maya calendar, Maya time philosophy, it's cyclic in nature. So the end of a cycle is always about transformation and renewal. And that's what the spiritual teachings in the Maya creation myth speak to. And incredibly enough, these spiritual teachings are actually relevant for what's going on in the world today. And I'll get into this in the presentation. So in my book, I kind of had an embedded kind of framework about an approach to 2012 that is kind of an invitation. You know, we can go into it as deeply as we want to, really. There's three kind of levels that I offer in my work. One, again, is the nuts and bolts reconstruction of the ancient astronomy connected to the calendar and what 2012 meant. That's more or less an academic or scholastic sort of pursuit, documentation and bibliographies and all that stuff. And that's where my galactic alignment theory comes from, or my 2012 alignment theory speaks to that. But as I mentioned, we can also identify spiritual teachings inside of the Maya traditions, the Maya creation mythology. These spiritual teachings are actually identifiable as universal, perennial wisdom teachings. You know, here I sort of follow the lead of the great mythologist Joseph Campbell. Some of you may be familiar. Joseph Campbell, he would look at the world's mythologies and religious traditions, and he had this great ability to peel back the culture-specific layers, like a certain deity has a certain name, or it came from Islam, or it came from Hinduism, or Buddhism, or Christianity, and he'd be able to identify the deeper archetypal thing going on. You know, the essential principles at work in these mythological stories, and thereby identify that universally shared layer in which, you know, the you have these universal principles of spiritual unfolding and teachings going on. Well, so too in the Maya creation myth, I realized that there are these universal principles. So we can identify those in the creation myth. That's like the second level of going into the Maya material that relates to 2012. The third level is the real challenge, and that is to engage the direct initiatory experience of connecting with those universal principles. That's sort of like the mystery school invitation, you know, to actually have a direct inner gnosis or a direct inner experience of those universal principles that relate to consciousness and awakening, these kinds of things. I think we've all, in our own ways, have had glimpses of what that's about. And that's not really something that I sort of offer in my work, really. I point to, you know, the reality of initiatory schools and, you know, well, I guess in some ways I do sort of advocate, say, for example, going down to Guatemala to experience some of the Maya temples or hang out with the contemporary Maya, the K'iche Maya, who do fire ceremonies. In fact, I work with a nonprofit called the Maya Conservancy in Guatemala, and last year we went around to five different sites, including Izapa, which is going to feature into what I focus on here. Izapa is the place where this long count calendar seems to have been formulated. It's been the centerpiece of my work. But I suggest that, you know, if we want to have a direct experience of the transformative power of, say, the fire ceremony, then, you know, go to the sacred sites and hang out with the Maya. Okay, so the long count calendar, there are dates and events recorded in the long count calendar. Here we have a sculpture from, I believe, Carigua. And you can kind of see some of the dots and the bars and the hieroglyphs. Well, it's not just about calendrical mathematical accounting or something. There's a lot of information embedded in these narratives, including astronomy, ritual, religious beliefs, history, deep time, mythological things with supernatural deities and the creation of the world, and cosmology and king-making rites. And there's a lot of stuff going on. So just for the basics, the long count calendar is what gives us the 2012 cycle ending date. And it's basically, usually you find it with five place values. and the kin level is just a day. The huinal is 20 days. A tun is just under a year, 360 days. One katun in the long count calendar is just under 20 years, and one baktun is just under 400 years. So it's kind of like this wheels within wheels harmonic system of time that expands based upon 20, except you might notice for the tun level. And that's just a fact of the system. You know, they probably wanted to approximate the solar year with a 360-day cycle, and in many ways that's the building block. But in any case, we have this creation mythology of 13 baktuns, 5,125 years. We have texts from Carigua and Copan and Palenque and several other sites that talk about the creation mythology when the last 13 baktun cycle ended. That was in 3114 BC. And then it kind of like cycled back to zero, and then we started counting up in the long count again. And so you might find a date carved in stone on one of the monuments that says 9 baktuns, 16 katuns, 4 tuns, 1 huinal, and 1 day have elapsed since the fabled zero date in 3114 BC. So if you add up all those amounts, you get May 7th of 755 AD. We can have very precise accountings of stuff that was going on at the Maya sites, almost on a week-to-week basis. You know, it's true that there's only 4 surviving Maya books. Many of them, most of them, were destroyed at the time of the conquest, and that's a huge tragedy, you know. And we're figuring out amazing stuff from the Dresden Codex and the Madrid Codex and the Paris Codex. But we also have all these carved monuments that have texts. And we have ceramic vessels that are painted that have hieroglyphic dates and narratives and hieroglyphic inscriptions on them. And so we do have a lot to go on that helps us understand what the ancient Maya world was about and what they were thinking and their daily lives and beliefs and rituals and kingship and all this stuff. So we do have a lot to go on. So we do know that according to the correlation, and this is kind of a tricky thing, I won't go into this a lot. The first 4 years that I was studying the Maya calendar, I wanted to verify this whole idea of what day it is today in the Maya calendar. You know, this is the correlation question. And this is also where you find a lot of misinformation out in the marketplace, where people are inventing their own systems and they have their own end dates and stuff. Well, for 4 years I looked at this, and it basically, the case is closed. I mean, an interdisciplinary set of evidence that scholars have looked at for over 100 years all feed into the conclusion that the cycle ending falls on December 21st of 2012. That evidence is like, you look at the inscriptional dated narratives, and you can compare it to astronomy and moon cycle periods. That's one set of evidence. Then you have the carbon 14 dating stuff. That's another set. You got the historical documents. You got all this different stuff that just factors into that one conclusion. So case closed on that. That was the sort of the beginning phase of my research, and then I was sure that the cycle ending fell on December 21st of 2012. So we can say that there is one date, you know, that is important in this construct. So another thing we have is quite amazing, actually, is carved hieroglyphic stairways. The hieroglyphic stairway at Copan is like this narrative. It's quite amazing, and it tells all the stories. There's so much going on here. And in fact, now we know from different Maya sites, we have over 22 hieroglyphic stairways that have been found. So it's a great amount of information that we can work with. Hugh mentioned La Venta, which is an Olmec site going back to about 1000 BC. And I find this site really interesting because there's sort of astronomy embedded in the orientation of the main temple buildings at the site. As Hugh was talking about, the Olmec are this mysterious people. They're often referred to as the great mother culture of Mesoamerica. There's great mysteries in their origins, where they came from, and they landed or set up house in this Gulf Coast region here. Here's La Venta, here's Palenque. Copan is over here. Izapa is down here. So there's a lot going on in this region here. The Yucatan up here is kind of a latter day phase of the Maya civilization. The Maya classic period went from about 200 AD to 900 AD. There's a lot going on up here in Chichen Itza in about 900 AD. So a lot of interesting stuff going on there. But with La Venta, what's interesting about this is that a researcher archaeologist named Marion Popino Hatch, she realized that there was a strange thing that happened at La Venta where they tore down the main axis of the buildings and then reoriented it just like 2 degrees for some reason. Why would they do that? That's a huge amount of effort, you know. She realized that the main axis, as usually is the case with Maya cities, it was lined up with the stars in a certain way. Okay, that's cool. The Maya liked to orient their cities based upon a celestial template. You know, it's that as above, so below principle. So they believed that their cities had to be oriented correctly to the larger cosmos, so there could be like a harmonious relationship going on there. Well, problem is that there's this thing called the precession of the equinoxes that shifts the positions of the stars on the horizon where they rise. And so what was going on there, in the northern skies, the rise place of a certain star in the Big Dipper had moved along the horizon a little bit with the precession over about 150, 200 years. So they tore down the whole thing and they reoriented it. So this tells us that the Olmec at La Venta, 1000 BC, were at least aware of the precession of the equinoxes. Not sure if they could calculate it at that time, but at least they were aware of it. In fact, I think that because they were so obsessed with time and calculating cycles and having a correct orientation to the larger universe, that they wanted to get a handle on this thing. And I think at that time, a guild of sky watchers really, you know, got on it with figuring out this shifting thing in the sky. And so about 800 years later, is when the first carved monuments in the long count start appearing. 800 years is a long time to be measuring the sky and tracking the shifting. And I think that they were able to get it done, and I think that it happened at Izapa. Before we get to Izapa, I'd like to share some excitement that I have over this incredible area of northern Guatemala. I guess I haven't been paying attention that much, but I did a lot of my research in the early 90s, mid-90s, and I kind of am amazed at this site, this area called El Mirador in northern Guatemala. It's up here, kind of, here's Guatemala. And it's this rather large region called the El Mirador Basin, right on the border with Mexico. And here it is blown up here. It's kind of north of Tikal. Tikal's the great site in the Flores, Petén, Lake Flores. And Petén Itzá, and so it's in a, you know, this is still like jungle area up here. And El Mirador is the biggest site in this basin, in which you have five or six other smaller sites. And I started to realize when I was down in Guatemala about 2 years ago, I was speaking at a conference there and I saw Richard Hansen's presentation on El Mirador. This is all pre-classic stuff. This is a whole sort of phase of Mesoamerican civilization that arose before the classic period Maya began in 200 AD. By 150 AD, El Mirador was falling. So there's this incredible thing that happened for a couple hundred years, around maybe 2100 years ago. And El Mirador is absolutely quite astounding. Here is the El Tigre complex at El Mirador that the archaeologists have figured out, because the ruins are still there in the jungles and they've been doing some work there now. I've got this superimposed over this thing in the middle. You can't really see it, but I wanted to give you a sense of the size of this El Mirador temple complex. What's going on here is that the El Mirador temple complex is basically enclosing the entire central plaza of Tikal. So it's larger than this. The whole thing is larger than the central plaza from Tikal. That's what this kind of shows here. And you can kind of see the Tikal temples in here a little bit. But now I'll show you where this thing is in the entire cityscape of El Mirador that's been reconstructed by the archaeologists. Oh, I'm sorry, this one's first. Oh, actually, that pyramid right there is actually part of a larger construct that's all man-made. You know, there's a larger base that was made. And there's more stone in here than in the Great Pyramid of Egypt. Now I'll show you where this is in the city of El Mirador. Way over there. I mean, that's probably the center, really, but there's all these other temples. I mean, it's incredible, this El Mirador Basin. I think that in the next 10, 15, 20 years, we're going to have so much new data and information pointing out of there that we are going to have to revise world history, basically, right? I mean, here we are, it's 2011. You know, the mainstream kind of perception is that is still being presented, that, you know, it's still being shoved down our throats that the ancient Maya were these barbaric, bloodthirsty, hearts tearing out, you know, thanks to the Hollywood directors, and that's just so ridiculous. You know, what I try to do in my work is to emphasize and to highlight and to sort of be a spokesman for the most brilliant aspects of what the ancient Mesoamerican people had accomplished in their sciences, in their religion, in their mythology. Did they engage in human sacrifice or in warfare? Yeah? So what? Anglo-Saxons at the same time were doing human sacrifice. Any high civilization is going to be expressing the full spectrum of barbarities and epiphanies at the same time. So what? Why do we hold the Maya to a different standard? You know, at the same time, they were also doing incredible calendrics and mathematics and astronomy. And one of the things that I find challenging and perhaps threatening to our Western Judeo-Christian scientific empirical model and way of perceiving the universe is what I call the non-dual philosophy that the Maya clearly had in place. It's this idea that the opposites are united. You know, like I said before, they don't compartmentalize the different domains of experience, you know, like the physical world and the spiritual world. They see these things as interdependent, interrelated. We see this quite clearly in this carving where you have the enfleshed face on the right combined in a nice unified image with the skull face on the left. This is simply saying that life and death go together. That's the non-dual perspective. That's the idea of the holistic worldview or the transcendence of duality. The 260-day calendar itself embodies this principle quite nicely in the combination of 13 numbers and 20-day signs, which I have in my diagram here. You've got the 20-day signs, the sacred day signs, and the 13 numbers. So there's kind of this permutation that goes on in the 260-day calendar. The day signs and the numbers toggle forward together. So it goes from like 1 Emish, 2 Ik, 3 Khan, 4 Akbal, 4, you know, 5 Chikan. They toggle off forward, but they come back to the beginning every 260 days because 13 times 20 is 260. The way that this number 260 unites the domains. It's sort of like that as above, so below principle. We see it quite clearly in how the Maya themselves today think of the 260-day cycle. Where did it come from? Why is it so important? Well, the Maya of today offers an explanation for it, the fact that it corresponds roughly to the human gestation period, 9 months. Maya midwives, they basically take the first day that a woman misses her period and she's pregnant, they add 260 days and they calculate the birth of the child. That's like that first cycle of unfolding that we as human beings all experience. You know, the unfolding of our physical bodies as human beings, that embryogenesis process in 9 months. It's incredible. Well, it's also the interval between the planting and harvesting of corn in the highlands of Guatemala. And according to the mythology, human beings are made from corn dough. So it's part of the mythology. We eat corn and our bodies are made from corn. So it's part of the mythology. But nevertheless, you have that same 260-day cycle operative on the level of earth agriculture, an earth cycle, agricultural cycles. Most amazingly, the 260-day calendar is used as kind of a key to the almanacs that you find in like the Dresden Codex and the Madrid Codex, the almanacs that were used by the Maya to predict the cycles of the heavens, the periods of Venus and Mars and the moon. That's the celestial aspect of this. So all these different domains, these three different domains of human experience, are united by this 260-day sacred number. It's like that as above, so below principle. Now, in my work, I have been interested in Maya shamanism primarily because Maya civilization was shamanistic in nature. The Maya king was a kind of high shaman, and it was the king's obligation to mediate the celestial energies into the kingdom, to keep the kingdom in balance. So the Maya king had to actually go on vision journeys into the cosmic center or the transcendent sort of astral plane domain and communicate with the ancestors and retrieve sacred knowledge. Is that something back here? It's beeping. I don't know. There's a backpack right there, so I don't know what's going on. TSA. It's probably going to call the TSA. There's an unsupervised bag. Don't get me started. I travel through airports so much. It's an ongoing thing. Anyway, shamanism is really an important part of what was going on in the Maya world, and so it actually conveys or confers the non-dual vision. You know, these kinds of things, shamans, they do healings, and so shamanism is part of this whole integration of the subjective and the objective, the physical and the spiritual, the perception of the interdependence of all things that the Maya worldview is based on. Which again, you know, not to hammer the point too hard, but our own worldview comes from this Cartesian dualism. And I think that this strikes to the heart of the crisis of the modern world, because with the separation of these different aspects that are really united, it gives rise to the environmental crisis, and decisions can be made without any kind of conscience as to the effects or the interconnections between things. And so you get basically the war on nature by the corporate banksters, and which is basically a war on us. So that's where some of that's coming from, I think. Now, a little aside here, I want to share with you one of the things I discovered in my research, which has kind of flown under the radar. You know, it is connected to the 2012 thing, but in a different sort of way. I've been very interested in astronomy and reconstructing the astronomical beliefs and knowledge of the ancient Maya, and there's different ways that I found that the Maya were tracking astronomy and were in fact tracking the precession of the equinoxes. And one way that they did this, I believe, has to do with this well-known event that happens every equinox at Chichen Itza. Some of you may have been there. If you go to Chichen Itza at about 4:30 in the afternoon, a shadow serpent is cast from the corners. And it's like a serpent of shadow, serpent of light that comes down the northern balustrade. And we know that it's oriented this way with the snake's head at the bottom, because there is a stone head at the bottom here. And then the cenote is off this way. And so it's like the serpent's coming down from the sky through the center of the pyramid, the little temple up here, there's a chakmul up there. And it comes down and then goes off and slithers down to the... So it's kind of like an image of the connection between the sky and the earth and the underworld, which is that shamanistic world axis that connects the three domains. And I noticed that there's all these symbols of the inverted serpent. Like at Chichen Itza, you have these stone columns with this. Here's actually the rattle of the serpent up here at the top. And Maya kings held these wands or scepters of rulership. And they were like that too. They had the snake head at the bottom and they would hold them, and then they had a deity up here by the where the tail would be. So it's like a deity-tailed serpent wand, kind of a symbol of rulership, like a staff kind of. And in fact, researcher Jose Diaz Bolio in Mexico, he pointed out that there are these king snakes in the Yucatan that have the rattle, but there's also often a little three-dot circular motif for some reason. It's just part of like the the biology of the snake. And the three-dot face, it's kind of like a little solar face. So now the snake itself is a solar being anyway, right? The snakes are often associated with the sun because they shed their skin and they go through this molting. So the sun renews itself every year in the annual cycle, and the snake renews itself with the molting of the skin and so on. So they're solar creatures anyway. But still, it's interesting that you'd have the sun symbol right here with the snake's thing there. And the thing that the connection I made that put the pieces together with this reconstruction is that the Yucatec Maya word for rattle is tzab, T-Z-A-B. That's also the word for the Pleiades. So we can complete this construct and identify what's basically an esoteric message going on here. In other words, that shadow serpent that appears on the equinox, that's only the visual manifestation of deeper mysteries that can be reconstructed. What I think is really going on here is that it's pointing to the snake's tail goes up through the middle of the pyramid, and then you have the sun and the Pleiades aligned in the zenith of the sky. Okay, so like if we looked down from above on this pyramid structure, it would look like this. This is the famous quincunx symbol that you find all over Mesoamerica. It's like the central Olin glyph that Beth was illustrating there. You've got the four directions on the corners, and you have the fifth direction in the middle. It's also a time thing. It's not just a space thing, like directional. It's a time thing, too. You have the four previous world ages of time that are united by the fifth central world age. So it's almost like a time-space equivalence thing. Way before Einstein, by the way. So this would be the zenith. The center of the construct is the zenith. This is pretty well known from, symbolism and work that scholars have done. Well, the zenith is actually, it's the exact center of the sky overhead. And within the tropical zone where the Maya live in Mexico, the sun can pass through the zenith. Up here in the north, even on the June solstice, the sun doesn't quite get high enough, to pass through the zenith. So if we're closer to the equator, we live within the tropical zone. There are 2 days every year that the sun will pass right through the zenith. It depends on your latitude. The days depend on your latitude. So at the latitude of Chichen Itza, this is latitude specific, at the latitude of Chichen Itza, which is about 20 degrees north of the equator, the sun and the Pleiades will join in the zenith of the sky. And it does so on May 20th. Which is 60 days after the equinox. Doesn't happen in every era. Here's the key. The convergence of the sun and the Pleiades in the zenith over Chichen Itza starts to occur in the 21st century, right now. It's like this is a processional star clock in stone. It's not just about the shadow serpent that comes down. There's this other thing going on there. It's like this is the symbolism and the orientation and the archaeoastronomy of this is actually pointing to a rare alignment in the cycle of the precession of the equinoxes that culminates in the 21st century. And that's in my book, Maya Cosmogenesis 2012, that came out 13 years ago. And it's one reason why we should think of Chichen Itza as an important place to go and celebrate, and how it's connected to 2012, roughly speaking. That alignment actually is, the nature of it is that it doesn't just happen in 1 year or something. It's actually, I suppose you could mathematically nail it down to 1 year or something, but, the nature of the zenith phenomenon is, and shadow casting and so on, it's probably in effect for over 100 years. But nevertheless, it seems to be the thing that's symbolically encoded into the Great Pyramid of Kukulkan at Chichen Itza. What I noticed is that, I've been here many times. I've been to Mesoamerica and Mexico many times. So I was here once when the shadow serpent is happening, and you can stand here and observe it, and it's like, wow, there it is, the shadow serpent. And how many of you have been there to Chichen Itza to see it? Yeah, all right. All right, it's a really cool thing to see. And then you can turn around and walk 100 feet over that way, and you're standing in the middle of the great ball court. They're very close together at the site. And this is what you'd see in the great ball court. scholars have always scratched their heads as to why the walls in the Great Ball Court are so high. They're ridiculously high. You can't play the game in there. Well, okay, well, that's not that surprising on one level, because often the ball game was not really about athletic prowess or playing the game. It was really like a stage for the enactment of the mystery play of the creation myth. The ball game is really central to the creation mythology, which I'll get into in a minute. So it wasn't so much about playing the game, at least in some contexts. Like, this was more like a ritual mystery play theater, you know. And part of the magic and the mystery, I think, had to do with these kinds of alignments, because the sun is setting in the west, the walls are so high that at the moment that this is happening, the lengthwise axis of the ball court is cut in half by shadow and light. Right down the lengthwise axis of the ball court. Well, that makes a lot of sense, because on the equinox, equal day and night. All right, so now we get into the 2012 stuff. Why 2012? That is sort of the question, right? That's kind of what piqued my curiosity in the early 90s and how I got into this research. Just a little aside here. Through the years, the first book that I got published, it was called Zolkin, Visionary Perspectives and Calendar Studies. I got the contract for that in 1992. Publishing has gone through major, major revolutions since then. It really was an exciting thing for me as a still kind of young guy to score a publishing deal, and I'd written some articles and stuff. And being an independent researcher, and so one thing led to another, and then I got another book deal for Maya Cosmogenesis 2012 and so on. And it's never easy to make a living as an author and a writer, as many of the authors know. It's like it's driven by your passion, really, so you keep doing it anyway. And in the mid-90s, I discovered what I felt to be the key to understanding 2012. So I made some decisions, and I said, I got to get this figured out. And I basically decided to live in a slightly renovated garage without running water for 4 years, work a part-time job to pay my bills, so that I could have the time to immerse myself in the academic literature and find more evidence for this 2012 alignment theory that I had uncovered. And that resulted in the book Maya Cosmogenesis 2012. And this is it here. It's basically that, you know, in terms again of focusing on what the ancient Maya themselves thought about 2012. The 2012 end date of the long count calendar was intended to target the rare alignment of the December solstice sun with the center of our Milky Way galaxy. That's a quote from the book. That's kind of a general way of framing what the galactic alignment is. The galactic center actually is quite large. I mean, visually speaking, astronomers call it the nuclear bulge, and it's quite wide. On another level of precision, radio astronomers identify more of like a pinpoint for the middle of the galactic, of the galaxy. And that's a sort of an abstract thing that really means nothing to naked eye sky watchers. But we can nail this down even more precisely if we want to, which I'll get to in a little bit. But this is a phenomenon that's caused by the precession of the equinoxes. It's a different way of tracking and measuring precession than that sun Pleiades and the zenith thing that I just pointed out. It's a totally different method. And the Maya seem to be interested and tuned into these different methods. So one thing I think that is sort of my real contribution to this discussion of understanding more deeply what the ancient Maya were thinking about is that I've been able to identify how this alignment complex is embedded into the core Maya institutions, like the ball game and the creation myth and king-making rites. And in fact, the way that I did this was by asking the right questions. You can't find the right answers unless you ask the right questions. And one of the first questions I asked was, all right, well, God, this is a long count calendar. It's got this cycle ending and it falls on the solstice. That's pretty interesting. Seems to be intention and embedded in this. Where exactly was the long count calendar invented? Who exactly did it? Is there a site or something? Maybe one of the sites or one of the areas? When? Well, the first long count dates start appearing in the archaeological record in the first century BC. That's the oldest long count dates we have. So that was pretty reasonable. And then I found the words of the great Maya scholar, Michael Coe, archaeologist who did work down there in southern Mexico by Azapa in the 1960s. He's actually still around. It's amazing. He's a very incredible researcher. In fact, he just wrote a preface for an anthology of writings on 2012 that I was fortunate to be able to contribute to, and that should be out later this year. I think it's called 2012 Decoding the Countercultural Apocalypse. All right, so as you can see from the title there, the scholars often comment on 2012 through the filters that it's some kind of New Age phenomenon in the cultural marketplace. In fact, it was only very recently that the Maya scholars themselves actually started treating seriously the topic of 2012, as if it was a true artifact of the ancient Maya calendar. Incredible. I mean, I've been doing this work for 20 years, and I've been actually in the trenches with the scholars to discuss and debate my findings and so on. And it's been so amazing to see how time and time again they would just react so reflexively as some dismissing and rejecting and not really hearing what the arguments were or looking at the evidence. And so now the scholars are actually looking at the Tortuguero Monument, which has the 2012 date on it. And this is really the proof of the pudding. And I'll get into this a little bit later on. But yeah, it was Michael Coe who said that, you know, Azapa's priority in the very important adoption of the long count calendar is quite clear cut. So that was the cue for me, enter stage left, you know, and I started doing my research on Azapa. What was available on Azapa was basically these incredibly clinical and archaeological reports by the Brigham Young University, who did work at the site in the 1960s and 70s. But it was so exciting. What I found is that there's all these carved monuments at the site of Azapa, which is this pre-classic site. It's like was thriving about 100 BC in southern Mexico by the Guatemala border. The archaeologists found these standing carved monuments, these pictographic monuments, more or less as they were left about 1600 years ago. The site was never ritually demolished like some of the Maya sites were. It was seemed to have been treated with respect as an honored place where for hundreds and hundreds of years I think that the Maya people came there. It was like an initiation center. And in fact, these carved monuments, here we have the hero twins facilitating the demise of one of the deities, the vain and false ruler named Seven Macaw. Here's the sacrifice of the cosmic serpent, which was kind of a creation mythos thing that led to the division of the three realms. I'm not going to go into detail, we don't have enough time, but what I want to illustrate here is that there's this whole cosmology involving the creation myth, the known and recognized hero twin myth, or the Popol Vuh, is first appearing in a very fleshed out form here on the pictographic monuments from the site of Azapa, which is credited with being involved in formulating the long count calendar. I'll get into a few of these monuments that are relevant. It's basically in the Azapa ball court where you find sort of ground zero of the 2012 prophecy. My work at the site is basically archaeoastronomy and interpreting the iconography on the pictographic monuments. And so the iconography on the monuments, that's basically an expression of the spiritual teachings of the creation myth. And then the alignments and the orientation of, say, the ball court and some of the other aspects of the site is basically the more scientific astronomy part. And they go together. So the ball court, here we have the lengthwise axis of the ball court. Back here, there were six flat stones that were found. And they were clearly seating stones. So people would sit here and they'd look out over the field of play. But again, this doesn't seem to be a ball court where the ball game was actually played. They never found goal rings set up on the walls. In fact, these walls are so flat that they're barely usable as, like, you know, in the ball game itself. This was more like I suggested as a place of the performance of the mystery play of the ball game as it relates to the creation mythology. So here's a close-up of the throne on the west end of the ball court, and those six flat stones are back here. You notice that there's like a head, and close-up, it's like a solar godhead that's emerging from between the legs on the throne. So it's like a birth image. It's like a birthing image, you know, the sun's being born. That's not that surprising, really, because, as I mentioned, the Maya king, he was like a shaman. And the king would sit on the throne. And when he sat on the throne, he was like the vertical axis. And he was positioned at the center of the cross. Thrones are kind of like symbols of the cosmic center, because the Maya king would symbolically occupy the cosmic center. And then as the vertical axis, and being a shaman going on a vision journey, he would connect with the transcendent higher wisdom and channel it down and birth it, dispense it, disperse it into the kingdom, into the world. And that's how the Maya king played his role in keeping the kingdom in harmony and balance with the higher cosmos. So it's not surprising to have a birthing image here on a throne. But if you sat on the throne, you'd look down the lengthwise axis of the ball court, and here's the walls. Well, what's going on over here? This is one of my contributions that was never before reported in the academic literature. And you know, here's the ball court here, or here's the throne here. It's underneath these green sheds, like the archaeologists didn't want them to erode more, so they put these green sheds up. There's another monument here. There's another monument on this opposite side here. It's a whole incredibly integrated, embedded sort of cosmology that can be talked about, but I'm just giving you the sort of the surface of it, the basic Cliff's Notes here. What's interesting here is that if you sat on the throne and looked down this way, the ball court lines up with the rise point of the December solstice sun. The December solstice sun rises over the horizon here, and it's so incredible. I was there and taking measurements. I did a lot of field work at Azapa over the years, as a matter of fact, all funded by MasterCard and Visa. And who I'm still indebted to for their contribution. And so the sun rises, and there's like this illuminating thing that happens. The Godhead that's being born from between the legs is clearly a symbol of the December solstice sun deity. It's a clear reading. The December solstice sun rises over this horizon. Here we have those six flat stones. Clearly people were sitting on these stones to view this off in this direction. And there's other things. This is kind of echoing in a funny way. And there's other monuments going on here. So what I want to point out is what was going on in the sky. So let's say we are at Azapa in 1000 BC. Okay? That's before the ball court was made and everything. But for the purpose of this diagram, let's just imagine that the ball court's there. We're sitting on the throne. We're waiting for the December solstice sun to rise. You know, the sky is still dark. It's before sunrise. The sky is starting to lighten a little bit. But what we notice is that arching overhead is the Milky Way. And there's a separation here. There's a separation of about 38 degrees between the December solstice sun and this bright band of the Milky Way right here. Longer ago, 3500 BC, the separation was even more. So what's going on is that we approach 2012, there's a convergence process going on that's caused by this precession of the equinoxes, the slow wobbling of the Earth on its axis. And what's going on is that for hundreds of years, the position of the December solstice sun, or thousands of years actually, has been slowly shifting into alignment with the Milky Way. Here's the Milky Way. It should be white, really. Well, actually, let's do this one. Here's the Milky Way. So you have the Milky Way, and you have the horizontal path of the ecliptic, which is the path followed by the sun, moon, and the planets. Notice this is like a cross. The Milky Way crosses over the ecliptic at about a 60-degree angle. And in fact, this was part of the Maya creation mythology. It's the sacred tree cross at Palenque and elsewhere. And notice this other feature here, which is the dark rift in the Milky Way, which is caused by interstellar dust along that thick accumulation of the mid-ridge of the galaxy. The Maya actually mythologized the Dark Rift. They called it the Xibalba Bay, the Black Road, or the Road to the Underworld. It seems to be part of this whole complex of symbols that relate to different things. Like, for the Maya, a certain sky feature might be mythologized in many different ways. This was part of the rich kind of analogy-based thing that the Maya did with sky lore and celestial features. So on one level, the Milky Way is a road. And then the Dark Rift would be like the Black Road. It could be a river. And in which case the Dark Rift would be like a cave that the river flows through. On another level, it's the cosmic ball court, in which case the Dark Rift is like the goal ring in the ball court. On another level, it's the cosmic monster, and then the Dark Rift is the mouth. On another level, the Milky Way is the great mother goddess, in which case the Dark Rift is like the birthplace in the sky. So, remember the throne on the west end of the ball court with the December solstice sun coming out from the birthplace? This is the birthplace in the sky. And precession has been slowly moving the position of the December solstice sun into alignment with the center of the cross at the southern terminus, or the doorway, of the Dark Rift in the Milky Way. Now, in my work, I think this is very fascinating because these astronomical features are front and center in the Maya creation mythology. Dennis Tedlock did the translation of the Popol Vuh, and he's got notes to that translation, and he points out the various astronomical features that are involved here. The Black Road and the Dark Rift and the cosmic crossroads and so on. It's also, well, there's many different ways that this kind of works, but in terms of the astronomy, I just want to clarify some of the misconceptions about the galactic alignment. You know, the full transit of the position of the December solstice sun through this nuclear bulge or galactic center area, as Beth alluded to, actually takes about 1,000 years. Okay, the precessional, this is quite wide, but what we have going on here is a more narrow galactic equator line that runs right through the middle, and of course the Dark Rift itself is a narrower place. And, of course, this would be the middle part anyway, so if the Maya were trying to calculate forward to an alignment of the December solstice sun with the crossroads, they would probably try to do it as accurately as they possibly could, based on the limits of what they were able to do as astronomers. And they arrived at December 21st of 2012. The fact is that the sun itself is half a degree wide, and therefore it will take 36 years for the December solstice sun to precess through the precise midline of the galactic equator. So this 36-year alignment zone is something that I put on the table back in the late 90s just to sort of lend some sanity to the whole hoopla that was arising about 2012. And this kind of misconception that, you know, there was something that was going to happen definitely on December 21st of 2012. Well, no, I mean, astronomically speaking, the thing that the Maya were trying to target with their cycle ending date of 2012 is really this slow process of precessional alignment that is hard to nail down to a specific day, year, let alone a day. This doesn't disqualify anything. You know, basically we have this process going on. The effort is to try to reconstruct what the ancient Maya we're thinking about and why they chose this date, and I believe that this is what it is. Now, in the marketplace, when I've tried to explain this to interviewers, and you know, there's a lot of confusion that arises around this. That's why I've had, you know, hundreds and hundreds of pages of material on my websites going back to 1995. Unfortunately, there's just an increasing amount of sort of an irrational superstorm of craziness around these things. And even you can go out onto the Google sphere and find the NASA astronomers and other astronomers that are completely dismissing this galactic alignment thing. First of all, they confuse it with a lot of other things that it isn't really. And then they just dismiss it. They even conflate it with Planet X and all this stuff. So a lot of disinformation out there, even not just in sort of the popular marketplace, you know, but in the professional sciences and the professional Maya scholars as well. There's a lot of it's a strange kind of, you know, 2012 is like sticky paper for the projection of all kinds of ridiculous things. And I've just been trying to be a voice of clarity and sanity about this. So this one monument from Izapa here, it's called Izapa Stela 11. This is what I first encountered when I first started studying the site back in 1994, late 94. I realized that the symbolism of this monument, it was basically portraying the galactic alignment. Here you have the December solstice sun deity. I say that because this monument, like the throne, faces the December solstice sunrise. His arms are outstretched. That's a recognized symbol of like a period-ending gesture, because the first father, primordial solar deity at the beginning of the age, measures the cosmos. So it's like measuring. It's a period-ending or period-beginning measurement thing. And you have this frog deity. And on other monuments at Izapa, you can kind of confirm this, like Stela 25, you've got the alligator. And frogs and snakes and alligators, these kind of water deities, these serpent deities, represented the Milky Way. And the mouth would be the dark rift. So this also is kind of a prototypal form of a later hieroglyph image called the upturned frog mouth glyph that actually is known to mean to be born. So we have a picture here of the December solstice sun in the dark rift in the Milky Way, and that is a picture of the galactic alignment in the years around 2012. Era 2012 is what I like to refer it to, refer to it as. So, you know, this is part of the reconstruction and the construct, but we can sort of go beyond the reconstruction of the astronomy and start to identify the meaning, the ideas that are embedded into this. And we can do this by looking more closely at some of those monuments that are in the ball court. There are other monuments there by the throne. Of course, we already saw that the throne represents a kind of a birth or a renewal image. But there are these two other monuments found right under the throne. One is like a serpent head, with big fangs. And it had a little circular ball in its mouth, or sun face. And so this is like a devouring, I think it's like a devouring transformational image. Kind of like that way that death and birth go together, death and life go together, like that first image we saw earlier. It's saying that, you know. In fact, that's part of what you find in the Maya thinking about cycles, is that at the end of a world age, at the end of a big cycle, deity sacrifice is necessary in order to facilitate transformation and renewal. It's a principle. In other words, like the old deity of the previous cycle must be done away with before the new year or new cycle can be born. This is really how the transformation and renewal thing works. In the Maya creation mythology, that old deity, his name is Seven Macaw. Macaw, like the bird. And in the creation mythology, Seven Macaw is the vain and false ruler who appears or arises at the end of the cycle. And he squawks loudly, and he's trying to deceive humanity and keep humanity stuck to a place of limitation and distracting them with his glittery ornaments. And the hero twins, what they're trying to do really is to facilitate the resurrection of their father, whose name is Wunhunapu. Their father got tricked by the Dark Lords. Seven Macaw is like the chief of the Dark Lords. And he got his head cut off. So the Hero Twins are trying to restore the head and the body of their father and facilitate his rebirth. And before they can do that, they have to do away with Seven Macaw. So deity sacrifice. Seven Macaw is a deity. He's the deity of the old cycle that's gotten all twisted and distorted, and now it's all about falsehood. So that deity must be sacrificed or done away with, and then the father of the hero twins, who represents the December solstice sun, can be reborn. So the creation myth itself is a metaphor for the galactic alignment process, I think, according to my research. And then the third thing here is the stone. It's like a picture of a stone goal ring and the stone ball. Well, that's obviously the ball game. Remember, this is all happening in the ball court, and this is all about the ball game. Well, if you look at the symbolism of ball courts being symbols of the Milky Way and the goal rings being symbols of the dark rift in the Milky Way, and how the game ball, actually this is interesting, in the creation myth, the head of the father of the hero twins becomes the game ball for a little while. So it's like the head that is born, the December solstice sun god head, symbolizes the December solstice sun, but it also represents the game ball. So the ball game itself, and I have a whole set of, you know, it's all well rooted and anchored in generally accepted things in the academic literature. You know, this isn't really all that far out. What I've really done in my work is to integrate, like have an interdisciplinary synthesis of all the academic literature and take sort of like a synthesizing approach. Whereas the problem is, like in academia, a lot of times there's all these specialists, you know, and they don't really talk to each other, so they don't really put the whole picture together. So what I was able to show is that the ball game itself is a metaphor for the galactic alignment process. And the spiritual teachings then have to do with the idea of, like, I think the ball game itself actually points to something very important here, is that we are indispensable participants in these processes. So the Maya creation mythology, this complex of ideas here that's associated with the galactic alignment in 2012, it's telling us that there's a opportunity for transformation and renewal, but we are the ones who have to engage that process. So there are spiritual teachings embedded here. And I'll get into that in a little bit more here. Well, we'll skip right past that one. Basically, yeah, well, this is the spiritual, this is kind of where the spiritual teachings come into play. So this monument from Izampa basically portrays the two centers of consciousness that the Maya believed exist within a human being. And they're represented in the myth by that seven macaw deity and by the father of the hero twins deity, Wanhunapu. They have a celestial component because seven macaw symbolizes the Big Dipper constellation. So he's up here revolving around the pole star in the north. There's the bird deity. And then you have the Milky Way, and the head of the Milky Way with Hunapu down here on the bottom, his foot is touching his snout. The head of the Milky Way would be like that nuclear bulge, and the mouth would be the dark rift. So this is the galactic center area, and this is the polar area. So there's like a dialectic going on between the polar center and the galactic center region. The deity associated with the galactic center region is Wanhunapu. And Wanhunapu is that deity that gets reborn or resurrected at the end of the cycle. He kind of represents the idea that we can come back into an integration, like a recognition or an awakening, a rebirth, an awakening to the unity consciousness, the interdependence of all things. It's kind of like recognizing that we are much more than just our individualized egos. And that's in contradistinction to what Seven Macaw represents as the vain and false ruler who's squawking wildly, and you know, he's kind of like out of control megalomaniacal egoism. You know, he represents the short-term profit motive of the selfishness of the ego when it's gone pathological, basically. And that's what needs to be sort of put back into proper perspective at the end of the cycle so that we can open up to and awaken to a larger perspective. These teachings, and again, I'm sort of doing a Joseph Campbell thing here. I'm sort of identifying the archetypal essential things going on here in the story. These teachings are really profound, I think. I think they're expressions of universal perennial wisdom teachings that you can find operative in many of the world's religions. So the so-called prophecy, if you want to call it, for 2012, is a recognition that at the end of the cycle, this archetype of out-of-control, self-serving egoism is running and ruling the planet. Sound familiar? I think this is really amazingly verified by what's going on in the world today with you know, the short-term profit motive of corporations and say no more. But the second part of the so-called prophecy is that, you know, this results from an imbalanced orientation to reality. And in some ways, we are all involved in the process of transformation that must bring about an inversion and a recognition that there is this higher perspective, there is a greater good, there is something larger that we are all part of, and everything is interdependent. And I think the challenge that many spiritually minded people are sensitive to these days is the challenge of awakening. And I think that the process of awakening must involve sort of a recognition of the illusions that keep us stuck to places of limitation, you know, to the dictates of egoism or other things that limit us in our lives. So, you know, this, we could go into this, you know, in quite some detail, but I just wanted to point out that these ideas are really the core ideas of the perennial philosophy. And what I'd like to really emphasize here is that these ideas that I've been able to identify as on the sort of archetypal level of the Maya creation myth, they're not just some quaint belief systems of a forgotten people. They are profound, eternal, like universal teachings. And Aldous Huxley was a great advocate and spokesman for what's called the perennial philosophy. In his introduction to the Song of God, the Bhagavad Gita, in 1954, he very concisely identified what the perennial philosophy is about. It's basically this idea that, you know, there's four points here. The entire world, including individualized consciousness, arises from an unmanifest eternal divine ground. Two, human beings are capable of having a direct experience of the divine ground and initiation into the true self. We can do that because it lies at the core of our very being. You know, we can't talk about it too clearly because it's basically an ineffable experience. You know, it's one of those things that's hard to really explain, but we can have a direct inner experience of that higher nature or that divine, eternal, infinite nature that lies within us all. But, you know, we have this sort of ongoing conflict because we possess a double nature, which is the finite ego self and the eternal divine self. So it's really about having a proper relationship between these two things. And I think that one way to think about it is that the ego needs to be recognized as orbiting the divine self. The problem with the world today, and what leads to a lot of unhappiness for human beings, is this false idea that the ego is the sole sovereign and determinant of all reality, and that it's like the center of the universe that everything else revolves around. So things need to be put back into their proper perspective, and that is the challenge. And, you know, according to the perennial philosophy and Aldous Huxley, the purpose of human life is to reunite the ego with its higher divine self, which is the source, center, and ground of all manifestation. In my various books, I keep coming back to the perennial philosophy because I think it really provides a well-enunciated framework for understanding the Maya spiritual teachings. And there's a whole tradition around it with brilliant writers like Kathleen Rain and Stella Kramrisch and Titus Burkhart and René Guernon and Ananda Kumar Swami. You know, this isn't really, I don't know how to say this, but this isn't like New Age stuff, really. I mean, there's various ideas in the perennial philosophy that have been, you know, talked about and have made their way into the New Age ideas and thinking and so on. But this is really more like an insight, I think, into, you know, the way things work. So, just kind of sum it up here a little bit. Let's see, I kind of lost track on time. Where are we?
1 hour 15.
1 hour 15? Oh, okay. So there are spiritual teachings that the Maya have for cycle endings that relate to 2012. And then there's an astronomical alignment that can be reconstructed in the material. And one of the things I was curious about in my work, after my book Maya Cosmogenesis came out, is as to whether there were other traditions around the world that had tapped into this. And I wrote my book Galactic Alignment, which came out 9 years ago. And just as a little teaser, I did actually find very compelling sort of fragments of a lost wisdom that comes down through the ages from the earliest times. And I'm not going to dwell on this too much because I want to share with you the recent breakthroughs on Tortuguero. And one of the most compelling things that I found has to do with Mithraism, the ancient state religion of Rome for 400 years, the Mithraic mysteries. It's like an initiation, a mystery school initiation. But it's quite easy to identify within the symbolism of the Mithraic mysteries this zodiac orientation. Here you have Mithras the bull slayer. And it's now recognized that Mithraism is basically a metaphor for the shifting ages of the procession. You know, the slaying of the age of the bull gave rise to the age of Aries in about 2000 BC. And then that was superseded by the age of Pisces at the time of Jesus. So there's these roughly 2100 year periods, 12 zodiacal ages. But Mithraism seems to be encoding this process. But I'd like to draw your attention, you know, there's this torchbearer with a upward torch on the left and a torchbearer with a downward torch on the right. That kind of makes a cyclic process, and you have the 12 signs of the zodiac on this dial around the middle. Mithras plunges his dagger into the shoulder of the bull. And the Pleiades are located on the shoulder of Taurus, the Taurus constellation. This is a symbol of the downward flow of energy and incarnation into material manifestation. And this region of the sky by the Pleiades is where the other crossroads of the Milky Way and the ecliptic is located. There's actually two crossroads. One's at the galactic center and one is opposite the galactic center, sort of near the Pleiades. And what this is basically expressing are these profound ideas that you find manifesting later in Neoplatonic doctrines and so on, where you have the gates of the gods, or the celestial gateways. I think Beth alluded to this as well, is that at the crossing points of the Milky Way and the ecliptic, you have the incarnation of the soul into life and material manifestation and incarnation through one of the crossroads, and then you have the excarnation of the soul going back up into the celestial paradise at the other crossroads. I'd like to draw your attention to this area down here because I think this laptop might have gotten disconnected from the power cord. Is that possible? Or is there a power, there's no power cord connected to it. It says it's running low on batteries. So I don't know, maybe we need to get the power cord for it. So let's draw your attention to here. We have all this stuff going on right here between the constellation of Scorpio and Sagittarius. And you know, here's the foot of Mithras, here's another scorpion. Here's another foot of the torchbearer. Here's the Draco serpent. They believe that's Draco. And so this is a place of great concentration in the symbolism of the Mithraic mysteries. And that's right where, between Scorpio and Sagittarius, that's right where the galactic center is located. Scorpio and Sagittarius and Ophiuchus. So that was just a little teaser. If you want to look at the deeper mysteries of how these things are related to global traditions, there's other stuff too with esoteric Christianity and so on. So let's see, I'll skip through some of these slides real quick, but I just want to frame for you that there's new information unfolding about 2012, and it comes from this site called Tortuguero. It was only about 5 years ago that Monument 6 from Tortuguero came to widespread attention. It's very, very profound and interesting because the 2012 date is found on the Tortuguero Monument. And I was able to go see it back in March. I was able to get into that closed museum that Hugh mentioned. And I took close-up photos of the monument. It's a T-shaped monument. And there's actually 13 dates in addition to the 2012 date on the right flange, which is right here. Here you have the 2012 date, and there's this ceremony that's going to happen involving the deity named Bolognocte. Who is Bolognocte? Well, to make a long story short, Bolognocte is kind of like Seven Macaw. He's like the chief of the underworld deities. Some of my photos promise to clarify some of the readings and the line drawings. There is new work by Gronemeyer and McLeod that's coming out about interpreting the entire text. Notice that there's all these glyphs and there's these 13 dates. One of these dates can be reconstructed from a distance number here, even though we're missing this left panel. The distance numbers can be used to calculate the dates. And the surviving distance number can be subtracted from the second date to generate this missing date. That missing date is the birthday of Lord Jaguar. Lord Jaguar is the 7th century king who commissioned this monument. And my photographs actually contributed to nailing down, it's a kind of a long, tedious story, but I got close-up photos here, and you can determine this sort of broken part of the distance number. And I was able to nail it down to basically 2 days. It's either one of these 2 days, November 28th of 612 AD or November 30th of 612 AD. So they're only 2 days apart. And if we look at the sky on Lord Jaguar's birthday, we see that the sun was positioned right at the cross of the Milky Way and the ecliptic. It wasn't on the solstice. 20 days before the solstice, because he was born 1,400 years ago. In 2012, you get the same sky picture, except it's on the solstice. See how that works? Precession has brought all the things together in 2012, but Lord Jaguar was born on that same image, and I think that's why he sort of claimed 2012 as his own on the 2012 monument. Pretty amazing stuff. And so you have this beautiful symmetry between Lord Jaguar's birthday here with the sun positioned right at the crossroads and the 2012 date here. His birthday is the first date on the monument on the left flange, and the 2012 date is the last date on the monument on the right flange. So there's a nice sort of structural symmetry going on here as well. And within all 13 of the dates, there are fully 6 dates that involve alignments to the crossroads of the Milky Way and the ecliptic in Sagittarius. They're like echoing, including a lunar eclipse that Michael Grove, the Maya scholar Michael Grove, was really a great progressive Maya scholar. He identified this lunar eclipse, and it's positioned right at the crossroads of the Milky Way and the ecliptic. Happened right after Lord Jaguar acceded to the throne in 644 AD. So, you might notice that this is actually very supportive of the astronomical alignment work that I put on the table 15, 16 years ago. And so what we have going on here is even more information from like Palenque. This is work that Michael Grof is also doing. I've been in communication with him, and we're working together on some of these things to uncover some of these things, but he's really doing progressive work on understanding my astronomy, including identifying that one of the creator gods at Palenque is clearly his birthday in 2360 BC is another date when the sun was positioned right at the cross of the Milky Way and the ecliptic. At that particular time, it was some 62 days before the solstice. But nevertheless, they were interested in these alignments to the galactic center of the sun. And of course, 2012 in the future, when the solstice comes together in all of it, that would be a critical time for some ceremony to take place. That would signify the end of the world age. And this, again, is basically what I've been talking about for many years. Now, the Lord Jaguar situation is actually really astounding, because I think that Lord Jaguar was setting himself up to be present for the 2012 ceremony. Basically sort of insinuates that at the end of the text, that Now, this is not that surprising. It actually works really well as a sort of a political rhetoric statement, you know, that he's going to be the one to be there at the end of the cycle, and that he's actually going to be the one to perform the sacrifice of Bolon Yokte, the necessary deity sacrifice in order to open up the next world age, the transformation and renewal. How could he do this? He's going to be dead, right? Well, one of the things is that Maya kings, they would often invoke departed ancestors, ancestor kings, to be present for and participate in contemporary ceremonies that were taking place. So I think that Lord Jaguar was thinking that he could be invoked in the future to be supernaturally present to perform the rite, the 2012 ritual. Pretty amazing stuff, actually. And that seems to be what's going on when you look at the entire inscription. So for Lord Jaguar, the future alignment on 13 Bakhtun cycle end date, and it's parallel to his birth date astronomy. It was either an extraordinary double coincidence, or the 2012 alignment was an already ancient knowledge. And of course, I've already done the work on Azapa, so we know where it came from, right? So this is really transformation and renewal facilitated by deity sacrificed, timed by the galactic alignment. This is basically an echo or confirming, you know, what I found at Azapa. So we are living at a time now when we are coming into a fuller appreciation of what 2012 meant to the ancient Maya. Astoundingly enough, it's happening right on the cusp of 2012 itself. And my latest offering is this booklet called Lord Jaguar's 2012 Inscriptions. What I did is I basically took six texts from the site of Tortuguero from different monuments. There's actually a bunch of monuments that we have from there. And they've been deciphered, but the decipherments are almost unreadable because they're done by the linguists and the epigraphers, and they're sort of rendered into clinical terminology. So what I did is I made a composite rendering of the life of Lord Jaguar. And this has an introduction, it has the rendering itself, and it has a commentary on the 265 lines of the rendering that explain the choices of what's going on there. And there's a lot of embedded astronomy in that as well, as that I tried to sort of like, you know, embed into the rendering. I only have three of these left, so if you want one, let me know. I've also got two of my galactic alignment books. Unfortunately, I was not able to get books here, but that's what I've got. I thank you very much for your time and attention.